Thank you. Absolutely fabulous to be here this morning. What a fantastic day Melbourne has put out for us today after a couple of days of sheer misery. So lovely to walk down here and enjoy some sunshine. So wonderful to be here and thank you so much. We do a lot of events at Sustainability Victoria, and this is absolutely one of my favourite days of the year. I love the energy, the excitement, the enthusiasm that you all bring with you. So thank you so much for bringing that here today, and really excited to see who are the lucky winners later on today. Speaking of energy excitement, thank you to Sammy J. Big round of applause for our host today, Sammy J. Agree with you totally. It's much better being here and seeing people in three dimensions, although equally when I heard the phrase online learning, it sent me back to a place that I said I'd never go back to, so I feel your pain. Thank you also for your fantastic acknowledgement of country and the recognition of National Reconciliation Week this week and its theme, Be Brave, Make Change. So a big welcome to any Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander people that are with us today. I'd like to acknowledge some special guests that will be with us on the panel this morning. Professor Mark Taylor, who I think's got a really, really cool job title. He is the Chief Environmental Scientist for Victoria, and he comes to us today from EPA Victoria. And Carolyn Jackson, the Deputy Secretary from the Department of Environment, Land, Water and Planning. Our other panellist, Jill Sparks, who's the Commissioner for Environmental Sustainability, she sends her very late apologies. She's unfortunately a bit sick. I think we all know that there's lots going around at the moment with the flu season, so Jill can't be with us this morning. So unfortunately for you, you've got me as a third panel member. I'd also like to say a huge thank you and welcome to our student representatives, Seema and Isabel from Vic SRC. I was going to give you guys full permission to go hard on the panel and ask lots of tricky questions, but now I'm on the panel, I'm not sure I'm going to give you that level of encouragement. But no, I'm really looking forward to having a chat about our topic, Now for the Future. Joining us later today is very exciting, the Honourable Lily D'Ambrosio, who's the Minister for Energy, Environment and Climate Change and the Minister for Solar Homes. So she has a big portfolio, a big job, and it's great that we'll have Minister D'Ambrosio here later on. And also I'd like to recognise the Sustainability Victoria Board member Kerry Osborne for coming along. Kerry will be giving out some awards later on as well. We can't run events like this without people that help us and support us and sponsor us. So I'd love to give a huge thanks to our wonderful sponsors, Bank First, the Department of Environment, Land, Water and Planning, Oz Pen Makers, Biofilter, the School Water Efficiency Program, the Lego Group, Reground and Replas. Thank you. So I encourage you during the workshop session out there, wander through, have a chat with people, look at the cool products out there, and yes, of course, build a Lego car. At Sustainability Victoria, we work now for the future by really trying to focus on two things. We help Victorians to reduce their waste by reusing and repairing their things and saving on waste going to landfill, which, as I know, really important to all of you in your Resource Smart schools, and helping Victorians to tackle climate change by reducing energy, recycling right, and also through education programs like this. Coming from a Resource Smart schools, which I can talk confidently about because I do come from a Resource Smart Schools. The school I went to back when Rock was young is called Manchester Primary School, and about 10 years ago, it actually won the Resource Smart School of the Year Awards. Yay. But coming from a Resource Smart School helps you understand why reducing waste, conserving water and energy, and protecting our biodiversity is so important. I want to acknowledge that schools are places that mean a lot to people, not only to the students and the staff, but to our communities, our volunteers, guardians, parents, many of you here today, grandparents, and even local organisations that do things with the schools. And as a result, our Resource Smart Schools community, it goes beyond the school gate. And what you learn at school has further influence than you sometimes realise. And so, on behalf of all of us at Sustainability Victoria, I want to thank all the students for your dedication, your leadership in creating a sustainable future by making your schools some of the most sustainable schools in our country. So fantastic work. To our teachers, thank you for pretty much everything. The work that you do in our schools and communities is leading a whole generation of change and giving them the sustainability literacy required to thrive in our clean economy future. The work you're doing in schools is helping to shape the future now. And to the whole Resource Smart Schools community, thank you. What we see today in our Resource Smart Schools, it is what happens when we work together for a common goal. And lastly, I would personally like to thank our education team at Sustainability Victoria. Thank you for your passion, your commitment to sustainability education and the Resource Smart Schools program. It's your energy, it's your hard work that means we can all be here celebrating together today. So I'm going to hand back to Sammy J and look forward to the panel. Thank you very much.
Matt, thank you. You'll be back on stage in a moment's time, but before you come back on to the panel, to the students on the Victorian Student Representative Council who are about to host the panel, I just want to say, when I'm interviewing politicians on the radio, there are two types of interviews. There's like the fluffy light one, which is like, what do they eat for breakfast, getting to know them. And then there's the thing called an accountability interview, when you have to go really hard. And the way Matt just said, please don't go very hard on me, makes me think he's got something to hide. So for the next panel session, I encourage you to go really hard and see what information you can get and really hold him to account. So please welcome not just Matt, but also the Victorian Student Representative Council to host our panel session.
A bit shorter. Hi everyone, my name is Seema. I'm a Year 9 student and I'm also a Vic SRC ambassador. Some of you may know who we are, but for those who don't, Vic SRC is an organisation that advocates for the opinions and students and voices of students like yourselves. That can range from decision making in the education system to sustainability in schools. Before we begin, I pay my respects to the people of Wurundjeri country of the Kulin Nation, on whose land we meet on today. I'd also like to pay my respects to elders both past, present, and acknowledge the important role that emerging Aboriginal leaders are doing to continue to care for this beautiful country we all share. So today, we'll be hearing from four very special people who are involved in sustainability and how it works in schools, as well as our communities. I'll be asking them questions that students yourselves have sent, and they'll be giving us their input. I'd also like to thank Epsom Primary School, Brentwood Secondary College, Somerville Primary School, St. Jude's Primary School, Victoria Lutheran College, and Winters Flat Primary School for sending us through their questions. And now I'd like to reintroduce Professor Mark Taylor, Chief Environmental Scientist, Matt Jennifer, the CEO of Sustainability Victoria, Carolyn Jackson, the Deputy Secretary of Department of Environment, Land, Water and Planning, and Isabel Holmes, one of our very own Vic SRC ambassadors. Could everyone please give them a hand? So our first question goes to everybody. What does your job entail and how is it linked to sustainability? Matt, do you want to start us off?
Thank you. That's a great question. So, you know that I work at Sustainability Victoria because I gave that away before. So my job is pretty much about sustainability every day. So obviously we deliver and manage the Resource Smart Schools program, and we do that with about 700 schools every year. So that's a key part of my job. But we also deliver a whole heap of other programs, about 40 programs in total. And pretty much all of those programs are really about helping Victorian businesses, schools like yours, community groups, and even your households and you as individuals to understand the best ways to recycle right and to reduce waste and to reduce our energy. So my job is pretty much sustainability every day, all day. And we do that in lots and lots of different ways. It might be about giving advice or information or tools to help people to understand the best decisions that they can make or the best behaviours that they can make. And I'm sure you know all about that with the campaigns that you run in your schools to help encourage your other students and families to participate. Or sometimes it could also be about maybe giving some funding or some money. So for example, if a company comes to us and says, we've got an awesome idea for recycling, we think we can do way more, we just need a little bit more help because it's a bit expensive for us to do it. So we might be able to help them and fund them and give them a bit of money to help them build that new factory so that they can do that recycling and recycle a bit more. So that's just an example of some of the ways that my job entails sustainability all the time.
Isabel?
Hi, my name is Isabel, as you may know. I'm a Year 10 student at Bacchus Marsh Grammar, as well as an ambassador at VicSRC. VicSRC ambassadors are Victorian students in Years 6 to 10 who work together to create real student-led change in their schooling communities. As an ambassador, I've been given so many great opportunities, such as being here today. I remember always having a passion for sustainability and the environment. I used to pick up rubbish at school and tell off people when they littered, which is why I knew I had to educate others on the passion that I have and why sustainability is so important. I have had the opportunity as part of to attend sustainability programs and information sessions on sustainability and how we as a community can become more sustainable. As well as this, I was able to be a part of a team of students who were able to pass a proposal to put solar panels and compost bins in the schooling property due to how we raised awareness on why sustainability in our school is so important. It was important to involve other students in what I wanted to achieve, and we brought a different skill and perspective to the idea and was stronger as a team to push our proposal forward. I was also able to educate other students on the importance of sustainability and how we can make a huge difference to our current climate change position we are in now. Talking to other people about what you're passionate about and talking to friends about great ideas you have can be so important in making sure your voice is heard and being able to change things that you're passionate about. Thank you.
Thank you, Isabel. Carolyn, Mark.
G'day, my name's Mark Patrick Taylor. I'm Victoria's Chief Environmental Scientist, and my role essentially is to ensure the science that we produce at EPA protects all the citizens of Victoria from harmful effects of pollution and waste. I support and manage a team of 100 scientists. Those scientists support the work of 650 EPA staff, and we work right across the state. It's a fantastic job, it's a great opportunity. I never knew I was going to land in this position until July last year. And I do my best every day, as all the scientists do at EPA, to make sure that the decisions that are made in regard to the environment are the best decisions we can make at this possible time. And also they'll be protected into the future. I didn't get to this role by having a gold-plated career and schooling. In fact, I wasn't that good at school, I would admit. So those of you who are in this room who maybe not the world's greatest student, never give up. Find a way. Push yourself to the limit. Pursue your own desires, because that's what I did, and I studied geography originally, and I loved the landscape, and I loved understanding how it worked. And that then, through a series and a long journey, has led me to this position. And I can help contribute to protecting Victoria's environment to the best possible standard that we can do at this point in time.
Thank you, Mark.
I'm Carolyn. I'm the Deputy Secretary of Environment and Climate Change with the Department of Environment, Land, Water and Planning. It's a mouthful. And so what my job is, I'm responsible for setting the policies and developing the policies across the state that relate to the environment and to climate change. So like Matt, I'm living and breathing sustainability on a daily basis. I've got four areas that work with me, and they are climate change, which doesn't really need much explanation, but really working towards net zero. I have biodiversity, which includes things like assisting our threatened species and trying to help them become less threatened, revegetating land, again, to create habitat for species that are vulnerable or threatened. I have waste and recycling, which is doing a lot of work around increasing our recycling and reducing the amount of waste that goes to landfill or to your local tip. And I have an area called land management, and that's really about making the best use of national parks or the coast, land that the state owns or looks after, and making sure that it's in the best possible condition and when it's used by community or other groups that it's well looked after.
Yep.
So that's me.
Thank you, Carolyn. Now this is for Mark and Carolyn, both of you guys. What's the project that you've most enjoyed working on and why?
Me again, okay. So I guess I'm pretty new to the role. This is week 5 for me after coming back after having a baby. So I was in the role before I went on maternity leave. The thing that I'm enjoying most working on since I've been back is what we term the circular economy. What that is, that's in relation to the waste and the recycling area that I talked about just before. And what we're trying to do there is really reform the entire sector. So at the moment, there is an awful lot of items of products that go into your bin, to your landfill bin, and they end up at the tip and they really don't need to and they shouldn't. So what we're trying to do is change that. So there's a lot going on in that space, but one thing that we're trying to do is to increase the amount of, it's FOGO, but food and organic waste that is taken away from the tip and taken away from landfill and reused. And if we do what we're aiming to do, we're going to reduce the amount of organic waste that goes to landfill by about 650,000 tonnes a year, which is a huge amount. Something else that I'm really excited about that we're working on is something called the Container Deposit Scheme. That's where you can collect your Coke cans or your whatever it might be and take them to an area and get 10 cents back per container. That's going to make a huge impact. We estimate that there's about 2.9 billion containers that are currently, that will be subject to this scheme. So it's going to make a huge difference to the amount of waste that's going to landfill. And not only do we want to stop things going to landfill, but we want to make sure that they're being reused. So the idea of collecting them through a container deposit scheme is that they can be collected, taken away and reused. And so you're reducing the amount of new things that are entering into the system and new things that you're using, and we're reusing and recycling things that we are using. The last thing I'll say, because I'm conscious there's lots of other people, is single-use plastics. We're working to ban those, which is going to make a huge difference as well. So there's a lot of plastic that is used once, thrown in the bin, and you never use it or see it again. So straws, plastic plates, plastic cutlery, all of these kinds of things. We're moving to ban those next year, which will make a huge difference as well. So,
thank you, Carolyn.
That's pretty exciting.
Yeah, Mark, anything to add to that?
Well, the good news is my kids use fingers, not any plastic forks. So the project that I found the most exciting in my career is a program called VeggieSafe and DustSafe. And that program allows people to send their garden soils or their house dust for testing for trace metals. And that's quite interesting in itself. And we've served, something like 6,000 Australian homes for VeggieSafe and about 2,000, that's people's garden soils, and 2,000 homes for people's dust. But the important thing about that project is not us collecting the samples, it's listening to the community and them telling us, we want to know that our garden soils and our homes are safe to live in. And so it's actually working for and with the community to answer their questions. And that's what excites me the most. And in addition to that work, as part of the sort of the urban gardening project, I've done a project looking at bees and honey, looking at trace metal contaminants. And I'm very pleased to say I made the front page with Kylie Minogue one day on the Sydney Morning Herald. And I've kept that page. And obviously Kylie's a great icon of Victoria. But the important story there was that we were able to use bees as a marker for pollution. So that's been a really fun thing to do. But the most important piece of all of that work, it's provided a platform for educating the community about safe and sensible gardening, use of raised beds, mulching their garden soils. But in addition to that, we've been out to schools and taught schools about the methods that we've used. We've also then provided support and advice for community gardeners. And then we've done other work in communities that have experienced contamination, and they've been able to fix that problem. Students have been trained in that program. They've then gone on to do masters and PhDs. And so we've tried to close the circle by engaging the community and giving them answers. And that makes me feel really warm inside. It makes me feel really happy because I've done something I've done something. It's actually my students and my colleagues have done things, as well as myself, to help and support the community. So that's been, for me, that's been a real highlight. And giving back, it's great having an education, getting a PhD, but if you can give back, because every little thing matters.
Yeah, definitely agree. Thank you, Mark. So our next question goes to Matt and Isabel. Why is studying sustainability in school so important?
Great question, Seema. Look, I think the earlier we start talking to students about sustainability, the earlier our students will want to start taking action. The other thing that I think is really important with teaching sustainability at schools is that kids bring things home with them. Now, for my kids, it's usually grubby hands and the cold and flu, but also kids bring excitement and lessons and beliefs and behaviours back with them from schools. So hands up here, if you learnt something at your school about sustainability that you then took home to your home and asked your parents or families to do as well. Hands up, maybe it was a bit... Exactly, so lots and lots of hands. So instead of just bringing colds and flu home, we bring those lessons home with us. So I think that's really important. The other thing is that the things we learn as students, we're like, when we're young, we're like giant sponges, and we remember, well, we're supposed to remember everything that we're taught. But those things stay with us in the back of our minds. So the older we get, we bring those with us. So if we're taught those things really early, if we learn about sustainability really early, not only do we teach our families and our friends about it, but it stays with us forever. And when we get a bit older, it's part of sort of how we like to live our lives. So I think that's a couple of the reasons why I think it's really important, Seema, that we teach sustainability, hopefully in all schools across the state.
Yep, thank you.
Studying sustainability at school is so important as I believe students are the pinpoint of the future. We have the ability to come up with various initiatives and ideas for sustainability. As you can see today, so many amazing students have come up with incredible ideas already to make our community more sustainable, which is why it's vital students get a say in issues regarding sustainability. Without educating students on the importance of sustainability in school, they might not understand how our sustainability now has a tremendous impact on our future. Today's educators have a crucial responsibility in terms of sustainability education. It's essential to raise the next generation into eco-conscious, self-sufficient world citizens who understand the immediacy of environmental responsibility, as it lets students develop knowledge, skills, and motivation to protect the future of our planet. By emphasising environmental themes and sustainability in schools, we do more than give the next generation tools to take on environmental change. We give them a better future. Thank you.
Thank you. This next question is for Carolyn and Matt. How does your job impact sustainability in schools?
Thank you. Obviously my job is, as part of Sustainability Victoria, we run the Resource Smart Schools program. So I hope that all of the team that you can see around you today, all of the people that work on the Resource Smart Schools program, are helping to impact sustainability in schools by running the programs that we run. Now, I'm not necessarily one of those people. It's not my job every day to go and talk to schools, which is a bit of a shame because I think it would be really cool fun. But one of the things that I have to do in my job is to think about what are the next things in sustainability. So we do lots of research and lots of think about lots of new ideas for what could be next. What is the next step we need to take to supporting our change to a climate resilient economy? Or what is the next way we might be able to reduce waste or increase recycling? So I guess if I do my job right and Sustainability Victoria comes up with those new ideas and those new opportunities, then hopefully they end up in the schools with you and your communities learning about the next lot of changes that you can make in your schools as well. So that's how my job hopefully contributes to sustainability in schools.
Thank you, Mark. Carolyn?
Thank you. So as I mentioned, my job is responsible for setting the policies across the state. So if I use climate change as an example, we've recently come out with a climate change strategy which talks about reductions in emissions. So hopefully 50% reduction by 2030 is what we're aiming for and we're on track to do. So by setting those kind of targets and those kind of strategies, it then influences the rest of the state, I guess, to come up with programs and initiatives that will achieve those reductions in emissions. So solar panels on schools, as an example of one, that's obviously about the positive environmental side, but it will help us reduce our emissions and move to renewable energy. So I'm sort of, I guess my team, and it's about 600 of us, are working to set those policy settings, which mean that then we can implement programs or initiatives that will lead to sustainability in schools. So whether that's tree planting or whether that's solar panels or in my other area of the department, water efficiency, they're all contributing to the sustainability in schools.
Wow, thank you, Carolyn. Our next question is for Isabel and Professor Mark. What are you most concerned about for the future in terms of sustainability? Isabel, do you want to start us off?
I am most concerned that if we don't begin to educate students on the need for sustainability and let them have a say that on issues that concern them, it will lead to catastrophic effects on climate change and the future of our country. If the educators of today don't involve students in sustainability and educate them, the youth will neglect to care about what happens in our country, which will cause beautiful things such as the Great Barrier Reef and small islands around Australia to not exist. I'm sure that the students here today and adults know about the rising sea levels due to Antarctica's ice melting. You may not think that they will impact us now, but in 10 or 20 years, islands like Hawaii, Fiji and Tasmania and other small islands won't exist anymore. And many things we have today, such as the rainforest and animals, won't exist either. I believe with great ideas like I've seen from students here today that we will be able to have a great impact on sustainability and the future of climate change. If government members start to get students involved in decision, we provide insights that adults won't be able to think of, and ultimately it is a decision on our future and what the country will be when we are older. And I, for one, would like to have a say on what we do to make our country and make sure it's still as beautiful as it is now in the future.
Thank you, Isabel. If I make a quick note about that, being involved with sustainability myself, I think it's so important to encourage the youth, so I completely agree. Mark, do you want to go on?
Yes, I'll say something which might be mildly controversial, and I say after listening to David Attenborough and some of the comments he's made, I think the issue for sustainability, the thing that concerns me the most, is population, human waste and consumption. And, you know, everybody in this room, we're all part of that. And I think we can see when we look at the globe that, and some of the issues we've talked about, sea level rise, impact on the reef, climate change, managing our waste, recycling our waste, plastic deposit retainer schemes, they're all in the same bucket. They all relate to the number of people consuming products at a rate that the earth can't really sustain. And I think that is our biggest challenge. But it's a very difficult challenge because we all know how difficult the population controls that were placed on China were. That was very difficult for the people. It's a very difficult question to deal with, but I think we all have to find a way of addressing it in our own way. And that's the thing I think that concerns me the most about sustainability. How can we achieve sustainability on the earth with the resources that we have in a way that the earth and ourselves can manage the waste in a way that causes zero harm moving into the future? It's a wicked problem, but I think we can't ignore it. And I think that's the crux of what we face in what I call now the century for the environment. And that's what this is. If we don't get it right, we're in serious trouble. But we can see, listen to what Karen always had to say and what Matt was saying, that it's clear that the dial has shifted. People are now thinking in the right way. We're moving things in the right direction. And this session today and this program is very much part of that. So that's the good news. The difficult thing is getting it right, and we have to be sustained.
Yeah, thank you, Mark. This question is for everyone. In one sentence, can you suggest how can we, the community, support students to get more involved in sustainability? Carolyn, do you want to start us off?
Thank you. So from my perspective, I think it's about educating and making students and the broader community aware of what can be done. It's so exciting to be here. This is more than one sentence, sorry. It's so exciting to be here and just to see... I guess, the future, to use Isabel's words, here and being so excited and passionate about sustainability and the environment. I would like to see that, you know, the entire MCG was filled of people that were working on resource smart schools or other sustainability programs. So for me, it's really about taking the learnings that you have and to Matt's point, taking it home, but taking it beyond that and getting everyone to understand the importance and the benefit of resource smart schools or other sustainability programs, because at the moment I don't think that there's enough education and enough awareness out there about what we're doing and why we actually need to do it and why it's essential for us going forward.
Thank you, Carolyn. Mark?
Little things matter. Everybody can do their bit.
Thank you. Very concise. Isabel?
Yeah, same as Carolyn. Mine's probably going to be more than one sentence. But I think we can support students in getting involved in sustainability by having more hands-on experience and making them aware of the importance of it. I know that students don't gain much by having a PowerPoint presentation in front of them with statistics and numbers. So instead, creating a fun, hands-on environment will encourage students to get more invested while supporting them to get more involved in sustainability. Before students' involvement in a hands-on program, only 41% believed they had the power to affect change. After the hands-on experience, 94% believed that they could change the world. Wouldn't it be something to see that initiative reflected in schools and programs across our nation? Students can get involved in sustainability by speaking up and talking to others around them and making them know how important sustainability is. I was able to put in place some great initiatives into the schools and community. Although they are small, they'll make a huge difference in the future. If you guys are able to talk to other students around you, you can make a difference and make your community more sustainable, which is a step in the right direction for climate change. Thank you.
Thank you, Isabel.
I should have gone first and let Isabel go last because it's hard to top that. From my perspective, I'll be selfish and say I would love all 2,277 registered Victorian schools to participate in the Resource Smart Schools program. That would be one way that I think we could support students. But I think as an adult and a parent, for me, it's about lifting up. And that's when our kids come home with the bright ideas and the excitement to water that, to nurture that, to support that, to watch it grow, and not kind of stifle it or sit on it. So I think that's a way that we can all support our students to lift up and keep that excitement going.
Yep, thank you, Matt. Round of applause for everyone. Just to end it off, like Professor Mark said before, little things matter, your voices matter, and every little thing that we do towards sustainability matters for the future. So thank you all for your comments. Before we go, I wanted to thank the panellists for their input and time. Could everyone please give them another round of applause? I'd also like to thank the students who sent in their questions. Unfortunately, we didn't answer all of them, but we received so many amazing and innovative queries, so thank you to the students. And again, thank you, everyone. I think we'll leave it there. We're short on time, so I'll hand it back to Sammy.